Is it too early to declare one movie the best of summer 2011? Well, of course not. Summer ended 2 months ago. This is Movie Night. Hello and welcome to Movie Night, the interactive movie review show. I'm your host, Jonathan Paula. As with last week's episode, I'll once again be highlighting some of my favorite and least favorite movies from this past summer. And at the end of the program, I'll be showing your votes for what movie you selected as the best of summer 2011. Starting things off tonight, though, is the awkwardly titled Rise of the Planet of the Apes. Released on August 5th starring James Franco and clocking in at a very brisk 105 minutes, Rise grossed almost $500 million worldwide. Although closely resembling the premise of the fourth film in the original series, 1972's Conquest of Planet of the Apes, this film was by all accounts not a true remake, but rather a re-envisioning of the ideas set forth in the original five films. Speaking of which, the 1968 original starring Charlton Heston was groundbreaking for its use of prosthetic makeup, and 2011's reboot similarly breaks ground with its use of performance capture technology. Andy Serkis' portrayal of the CGI ape Caesar is a remarkable achievement and easily the standout character in the film. Resembling elements of Deep Blue Sea, the plot follows Franco playing a scientist who is searching for a cure to Alzheimer's disease for his dying father by testing radical gene therapy drugs on a series of chimps. Things go wrong at the lab and Franco is forced to raise a baby monkey at home and continue his research there. Years later, this chimp Caesar, now grown up, is showing signs of advanced intelligence, and unfortunately, signs of advanced aggression as well. When he's placed in the San Bruno Primate Sanctuary, he uses more canisters of this magic drug on the rest of his ape prisoners and attempts to start an evolution revolution. Unlike the original, there is very little here in way of political commentary. The ape revolt is hardly analogous to issues with society. Even still, though, the story is fascinating and well told, with great performances by most of the cast. I say most since Frida Pinto's contribution to the story as Franco's love interest was severely lacking in terms of development and screen time. I'm honestly not even sure what the point of her character was. John Lithgow, however, as the Alzheimer's-stricken father, does a terrific job playing opposite his primate counterpart.
Answer the goddamn question! What were you doing?
I have a car just...
Okay,
just,
you know, it's not obviously...
I'm done, car. I'm done. The police can handle
this. No, there's nobody here.
Just stay right there! Speak of the two of you.
I'm not going.
Just stay right there.
As we watch Caesar struggle with his identity, we're treated with some terrific references and throwbacks to the Heston era apes. Some subtle and some very overt. One iconic line from the original comes back during a monumentous scene here. More or less a cautionary tale about the dangers of oppressing our five-fingered friends, Rise, although beautifully executed, is nothing more than an entertaining sci-fi action film, with incredibly oppressive computer animation. There is some great depth and arc to Caesar's character, and a third-act sequence on the Golden Gate Bridge that is truly thrilling, but there's no real message here, and the film barely deviates from its very predictable conclusion. The reboot is a far cry from the achievements of the 1968 original. It is definitely fun and exciting, though, and I thoroughly enjoyed it. The final scene that very clearly hints at one or more sequels will leave you wanting more from this classic franchise. Rise of Planet of the Apes, a fresh reboot with impressive apes. Well, that's my review. Now let's read some of yours from the YouTube comments. Here's the Rate-O-Matic to rank Rise of Planet of the Apes. An 8 and a 9. This is a great film, and definitely a worthwhile entry into the classic sci-fi franchise, that will now hopefully be introduced to a whole new generation. You thought the film was awesome, many praising the outstanding CGI work that really makes Caesar a leading character here, and not just an animal. Our second film tonight, which was easily the low light of the summer for me, is Apollo 18. Pathetically riding the coattails of the Blair Witch Project, which has been old news for a decade now, this film was built off the mind-blowingly absurd premise that the 8th mission of the moon wasn't canceled, but rather deemed top secret after the Department of Defense wants to send astronauts to place ICBM detectors on the lunar surface in case the Soviets ever decide to attack. Perhaps even more absurd is the filmmaker's decision not to produce this film like a typical sci-fi horror film with a laughable premise, but as an honest-to-God documentary built from the quote-unquote recovered footage of a space mission that supposedly happened. Such a delivery assumes two things, that your audience is brain dead, and that anyone on this planet actually enjoys these terribly fake documentary-style films. Since neither is true, Apollo 18 can pretty much be declared dead on liftoff. Originally scheduled for February 2010, Apollo 18's release date was astonishingly pushed back 8 separate times, with distributor Dimension Films refusing to screen the film for press until it finally came out on September 2nd. In what is obviously his first English-speaking film, director Gonzalo Lopez Gallego clearly has no understanding of character development or emotional investment. It was not until the third act of the film that I actually learned one of the characters' names. And keep in mind, there are only two actors on screen for nearly 90% of this entire movie. Coming in at barely feature length, this film still feels excruciatingly long at 86 minutes, with most of the film resembling a bad science experiment on the audience. Everything we're witness to was supposedly filmed by 70s-era film cameras mounted on the lunar craft or held by the astronauts, resulting in countless uncomfortable claustrophobic shots, lens distortion, and film grain, most of which shot on the barren wasteland of the moon in black and white. To say this film was nauseating and visually unappealing would be the understatement of cinema history. Even the editing curiously incorporates way too many shots of the decades-old film unspooling from its thread. Now, I get that the intention here is to make this fake footage look old and damaged, but as a recovered documentary that's supposedly made in present day, wouldn't these hiccups and unspoolings be cut from the final film? There is some semblance of a plot here, when the astronauts discover the remains of a Soviet craft on the moon, destroyed by an unknown alien life form. To think that Soviets actually did land on the moon, and in secret, is an intriguing premise, and one that is unfortunately completely ignored. Instead, we're meant to believe that moon rocks can sprout legs, infect humans, and cause them to go insane.
Yeah, perfect. Okay, let me get a shot of you with a limb in the background.
Nate, look at this.
What?
Look at this! The flag's gone.
Houston, Liberty. Did you see anything unusual in the Westinghouse last night?
We got some interference and dropouts.
Our flag is gone.
What? Say again.
It's no surprise that NASA chose to distance themselves from this wreck. It's missing characters, purpose, color, an ending, and even a soundtrack. The hokey tagline of the film reads, "There's a reason we've never gone back to the moon." When really, someone should have told the producers, "There's a reason that Apollo 18 was canceled in the 1970s. Do yourself a favor and avoid this film, because apparently, failure was an option. Well, that's what I think about Apollo 18. Now let's see what you had to say about it in the YouTube comments. Once again, here's the Rate-O-Matic to rank Apollo 18. A 2 and a 5. Missing almost everything that makes a movie enjoyable, I thought this film was simply crappy. There was apparently something you liked about it, though, and your scores averaged out to an all right. And now that those reviews are finished, it's time to announce the best movie of the summer of 2011, as voted on by the Movie Night audience. So here we go, the top 5 movies of this past summer, starting appropriately with the 5th X-Men film, First Class. At number 4 is Rise of Planet of the Apes. At the 3 spot is, once again appropriately, Transformers 3, Dark of the Moon. At number 2 is Super 8. And for the best movie of the summer of 2011, Harry Potter 8, The Deathly Hallows Part 2. So there you have it, your picks for the best summer movie. And you're probably wondering what I think about Harry Potter. Well, truth be told, I haven't watched it yet, but when I finally do, there's a good chance I may even devote an entire episode of Movie Night to all 8 films, if you're into that sort of thing. Anyway, that's gonna do it for this episode of Movie Night, so now let's take a look at what's currently playing in theaters with some tweet critiques. Remember, if you're going to the movies this weekend, make sure to submit your Twitter review using the JPMN hashtag to have it featured on an upcoming episode. Next week, we'll be taking a look at 2 new DVD releases, Friends with Benefits, the raunchy sex comedy starring Justin Timberlake and Mila Kunis, and The Hangover 2, the bachelor party adventure with Bradley Cooper. As always, I encourage you to buy, rent, or download these films and let me know what you think about them by voting in the polls below or by leaving a comment review. Thank you for watching Movie Night. My name once again is Jonathan Paula. I hope to see you right back here next Friday.